honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 118 on disentangling the mental hindrances and thereby escaping the samsaric suffering. Welcome here and thank you for your attention.
There's no self in here. There's no substance out there. Impersonal and void are all states and phenomena. Ownerlessness is a universal characteristic of being. Insubstantiality is a universal characteristic of matter. There's nobody home. There's nobody home. Individuality is an empty village. The best way to comprehend no self, anatta, is to begin with observing and reflecting on impermanence, anicca, and suffering, dukkha. Then eventually one comes to understand whatever is always otherwise and never the same identical cannot ever be an identity, a self. Whatever is always ultimately speaking suffering cannot be under the control of a self. Since if it were, then this self, of course, would by this assumed control, self-control, change whatever is suffering into pleasure and happiness. But no self can do that, since it is not in full control. If a self is not in control of itself, full autonomy. Can it then be a true self? Or is it just conditions that play out cause and effects? Question, who are you? Answer, something else. King Milinda the first, 100 years before Christ, asked the Arant Nagasena this question, who or what is the person? And the Thera then answered, Nasa so, Nasa anyo. The person is neither the same nor another. Nasa so, Nasa anyo. Neither the same nor another. Nasa so, Nasa anyo. Neither the same. Nor another. This is a person. It is from King Milinda's questions, Milindibhanna. So, there's no self as an agent of any action. There's no self as a feeler of any sensation. There's no self as the experiencer of any perception. There's no definable entity transmigrating at rebirth. There's no self in or outside any constructed intention. There's no self in or outside any bony frame of a body. There's no self in or outside any shortly sensed feeling. There's no self in or outside any experienced perception. There's no person in or outside any narrated biography. There's no I, me identity in or outside any individuality. There's no self in or outside any momentary consciousness. There's no self in or outside any remembered past memory. There's no doer experiencing any karmic effect of any action. There's no same stable identity, lasting even for a moment. There's no owner of anything anywhere, whether material or mental. There's no identity, neither inside nor apart from the five clusters of clinging, the five khandhas. Feeling itself feels. There's no feeler apart from the process of feeling. The state of knowledge itself knows, there's no knower. The conditioned activity, the triggered process itself acts. There's no actor. There is actually not any self, I, me, my personality, identity. Yet beings, since an endless beginning, passionately maintains this mere idea, this mental construction of a stable, enduring, yet invisible entity, supposed to be the self, I, me, ego, identity or personality, with which they then deeply and dramatically fall in love. Assuming such an idea, constructing such an imagination, defining such an invention is more than fatal, as it caused the constructor to come back to birth, aging, decay, death, and thereby to come back to suffering again and again and again for eons. This personality belief, this ego assuming, this self-imagination, this me invention, is the first hindrance, the first fetter, the first mental chain to break when progressing towards freedom, towards peace, towards bliss, towards Nirvana. Since here in samsara is only change, flux, transience, impermanence, passing, dissolution and disintegration. Here in samsara is only pain, suffering, dissatisfaction, disappointment, danger, frustration and misery. Here is only impersonality, egolessness, selflessness and ownerlessness, lacking any core or substance. No self is found, neither here nor there. Yet there is action, yet no one is doing it. There is a noble way, yet no one is seen traveling it. There is Nirvana, the state of Nirvana, yet no self appears to enter it. These are the facts. No constructed identification is worth clinging to. Let it go, give it up, relinquish it, release it. That is not agreeable, but is quite advantageous. Is not pleasurable, but yet is quite liberating. Is no self. Is not enjoyable, but yet it is absolute and deathless. Difficult and counterintuitive is this no self issue, but ultimately speaking, very rewarding. The best way to comprehend no self is to begin with observing and reflecting on impermanence and suffering. Then one will relinquish gradually this false view of I am. This ego tunnel is a prison. Seeing no self, freeze. Thank you.
Ice cold, frosty morning in Denmark, -2 degrees, frost white and clear. First ice is coming there, as you see, thin, thin, soft ice.
Hello to you, friends.
This is Dhamma on Air number 118, recorded in the late autumn, early winter in Denmark, the 26th of November 2018. There are three questions and one advertisement. The advertisement is again for the upcoming meditation course in North Carolina, which is a 12-day course, but one can participate as many days as one wish to. All the 24 meditation objects, or all the 40 meditation objects of the Buddha is gone through, and six of them is trained in particular. It's a very nice wooden hotel, and it will be a very intensive silent retreat focused on calm, samatha, and insight, vipassana. And you are very welcome indeed. Then to the three questions. First of all, of course, we have to have the intro. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. I feel very suitable to speak the Dhamma under a tree, though not in a tropical setting, but under a tree just as the Buddha did 2,500 years ago. Very settled, very peaceful, a good setting. So this most of this Dhamma on Air number 118 will circle around the hindrances, the mental hindrances, Nivaranas, that are hindering our progress towards Nirvana and our hindering our or blocking our way to enlightenment, to awakening. Why so? Because basically the hindrances causes ignorance to arise, avidya. And when ignorance arises, then also greed and hate arise. And from greed and hate and ignorance mixed up comes all the other mental defilements as jealousy, envy, lethargy, laziness, restlessness, and so forth. So the hindrances are what blocks our progress towards Nirvana. Have done it for so many lives that the Buddha, he likened them to five serial killers that were running around with a sword right behind you. And as soon as you were unmindful, then they will chop off your head. And so is it really. The question goes is question 362, and it goes like this. Since the Buddha and other divine beings like those living in the brahmic realm are so compassionate, and they really are, why can they not relieve the suffering of people and liberate them from the defilements? Why does one has to put one's own efforts forth? Yes, the classic saying that the Buddhas and all the other beings, they can point the way to the moon, but you have to go there yourself. So one has to make one effort oneself. And this is basically because these five hindrances, the internal part of them is basically one's own, their individual. One is also hindered by the mental hindrances of other beings, other people that interacts with one in society. But nevertheless, the main part of it is one's own hindrances. And they cannot be eradicated by someone else than yourself. They have, because there are specific antidotes, which we will come through now. So these five hindrances, they should be substituted with the opposite state. So the opposite state of hate is goodwill, the opposite state of greed is generosity, and so forth. Then so this one can do as long as one is aware of them and put forth effort. Even that is not that easy, but the first point is that one becomes aware of it. Ah, now there's greed in this mind, there's hate in this mind, there's restlessness in this mind, there's regret in this mind, there's laziness in this mind, and so forth. There's doubt and uncertainty in this mind. As soon as one is aware of them being present, then one can start to see them arise, then counteract them right when they arise, so they don't have any dominance.
Otherwise, they will have dominance for long periods of time, from minutes to seconds to hours to lives, to universes, where one will be dominated by this hindrance, that hindrance, a mixture of these hindrances, and so forth. So, they are first irreversibly eliminated when attaining nobility, that is to say, from entering the stream with seven lives left to Nirvana, seven rebirths left at maximum, as a Sotapanna or a Sohan, as they say in Sri Lanka, one who has entered the stream to Nirvana. Then they start to become irreversibly cut off. In this case, skeptical doubt is irreversibly cut off by stream entrance. So then this defilement is off. Then one has to go further on. At next level, Sakadagami, one who returns once to this human level to become enlightened, then aversion and desire has been halved or reduced considerably. And with Anagami, they are completely eliminated. But otherwise, the rest of the five hindrances are first eliminated at arahantship, irreversibly. But otherwise, they can be momentarily suppressed either by substitution or by meditation. So the five hindrances have to be worked down by each individual mind by this repeated suitable substitution. Sense desire, kamachanda, this desire to see something, hear something, taste something, touch something, and have mental states and ideas, think something basically, and want something. This should be substituted with attention to disgust. And this means basically what one is training by asupa meditation, disgust meditation, where one meditates on corpses or on skeletons. The nine corpse meditations and the skeleton scannings, basically. And because disgust and desire cannot be in the mind at the same time. So if you can induce disgust, then your desire goes away. This means that overeating and pornomania and such things, over-gaming and entertainment addiction, this will be eradicated. One will gain an off button to turn off these desires by turning attention rationally and by just substituting desire with disgust, turning them to a corpse picture or a part of one's own skeleton. Angry ill will, vyapada, should be substituted with gentle universal friendliness. And this is best trained systematically by metta meditation, meditation on universal friendliness. Basically, beaming in all six directions, may all beings be happy. Sabbasata bhavantu sukhitata. As a mother loves her only baby son. Irrespective of how they are towards you and irrespective of how these beings are towards others, all beings indiscriminately. Universal, infinite friendliness. Lethargy and laziness, tinamitta, should be substituted with enthusiastic energy by turning the attention to the elements of initiative, the element of launching, starting up, and the elements of endurance, completing the task. The last skeptical doubt, vichikicca, should be substituted with incisive examination. So this one starts to say, I will now turn my attention to this phenomena I'm in skeptical doubt about. How does this arise? What is its causes? How does it stay present? How is it maintained? And how does it cease? When it falls away, what is the mechanism of its falling away, falling out of existence? And this gradually makes one certain about these particular aspects that otherwise is shrouded in a envelope of doubt and uncertainty. The Blessed Buddha, he explained it like this, that Yatsavati, he said, is from the Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here. He said like this, just as this body is sustained by food, is dependent on food, and cannot continue without food, even so, friends, are the five mental hindrances indeed also sustained by a kind of food. They are also dependent on food and cannot continue without renewed feeding.
So the mental hindrances are fed when you come into contact with the world, with samsara. They can also be starved, then, and then the hindrances will go down, then the mind will become more free, more open. What, friends, is the starvation that prevents the arising of sense desire and blocks growth of already arising sense desire? It is frequent and careful attention to disgusting features of things. So instead of looking at the attractive features of things, the deliciousness of food, the attractiveness of the sexual forms and so on, then one looks, turns attention to the disgusting features of basically if the food comes, where it comes from, and it becomes too, when it becomes vomit and excrement and so on. And then this then stops this sense desire from growing even further. And what, friends, is the feeding for the arising and the growth of sense desire? What is it that makes it arise in the first place? It is frequent and careless attention to the alluring and attractive features. This food makes sensual lust arise and feeds also the growth of already habitual greed. So this means that there's these two features of all, or two aspects of all objects, the attractive aspect and the repulsive aspect. And it only depends upon whether you turn the attention to the attractive aspect, then greed arise, or the disgusting aspect, then greed goes down. So this is, one has to be aware of that and discriminate that with any kind of object. One can all, a disgusting feature is always the object's impermanence, that it's in danger of becoming otherwise and even going out of existence. This can always be used as a disgusting feature. But otherwise, there will be ugly or repulsive features also of other kinds, whether with human beings or external inanimate objects. There will always be non-attractive features. And this will make turning attention away from the attractive features and towards the repulsive features will let greed and lust go down. This means that one is then diminishing gradually, this mental hindrance of karmachanda, of sense desire. And what, friends, is the starvation that prevents the arising of ill will, and it also hinders the aggravation and inflation of already arising ill will? It is the frequent and careful attention to universal friendliness. This starvation prevents aversion from arising and evaporates all present anger. So, universal friendliness. May all beings be happy. May all beings be my friend. May I be a friend towards all beings. May I be the best friend in the universe towards all these beings. And may they also meet me with their friendship. So, we help each other through this samsaric realm. And what, friends, is the feeding for the arising and aggravation of ill will? It is frequent and careless attention to the displeasing and repulsive features. So here you can see the opposite mechanism is here. When you turn to the displeasing features, then ill will arise. This goes in particular for groups of people or single people. This, as soon as this aversion arises or is boosted, any habitual irritation is boosted, then one should turn mind to this universal friendliness towards all these beings. Then it will go away. And the more one does that, the more one is in the habit of doing that, the more one's mind will be balanced evenly, without either falling into lust or falling into aversion. It will stay in the middle. And what is the starving that prevents arising of lethargy and laziness, and which also eliminates already present lethargy and laziness? It is attention to these three elements of initiative, launching and endurance. This starvation prevents sloth from arising and stops already present laziness. So again, as soon as the mind sees there's laziness or lethargy in this mind, then it turns attention to say, what is needed here? Is it initiative? Is it launching? Or is it endurance? Initiative is only mental. Launching is also physical, mental and physical, And endurance is also both mental and physical. One completes the task without giving up. What feeds the emergence and deterioration of lethargy and laziness? Why does laziness and lethargy already come? Yet it is frequent and careless attention to drowsiness and the dullness of having eaten too much. So as soon as one becomes tired, a little bit tired, or have eaten too much, one feels full in the belly and kind of like a little bit lazy, then one should not turn attention to that carelessly. Because if one does that, then one follows, I need to sleep. I need to lie down. I need to give up my meditation. Sit, instead of lie down, instead of sitting up on the pillow. While actually it is the opposite one should do. One should, as Buddha does told us, redirect attention to initiative, launching and endurance. Then this lethargy and laziness will go away. What is the starving that prevents arising of restlessness and regret and also retards escalation of any already present restlessness and regret? It is frequent attention to this sweet, calm and peaceful tranquility of mind. This starvation prevents upsetting the mind and reduces anxiety and worry. So restlessness and regret, there is this calmness of the mind and calmness of the body. This is the substitution one can do. One thinks back on this calm one has before, in particular in connection with meditative experiences, and say, now there's restlessness and regret in the mind, what to do? There's this calm of the mind, there's this calm of the body. Then one is already two steps down, two gears down. Then if there's more remaining restlessness, then one repeats the stanza. There's calm of the body, and that's this sweet calm, this silenced tranquility of the mind. And so one is two steps further down. This works, so it's just a matter of substituting the detrimental hindrance with the advantageous quality of the mind. But one has to be aware that this hindrance is in the mind right now, momentarily. What is the starvation that prevents the arising of doubt and uncertainty and which also stops the proliferation of already present doubt and uncertainty? It is frequent, careful, rational attention and evaluation of these four dualities. There are advantageous and disadvantageous states, mental states. Advantageous kusala and disadvantageous akusala mental states. Some say also wholesome, unwholesome, can also be a translation. Next level of discrimination is that there are blamable and blameless states. This is not your own evaluation of whether it's advantageous or not, good or not. It is somebody else's, where they will blame you, possibly for this one. Stealing, for example, this is a blamable state. Giving is a blameless state. There are ordinary and exalted states. Ordinary state will be looking at television, and exalted state will be sitting in jhana meditation or samatha meditation. So ordinary, low down here, or exalted up here. Mental states of oneself or others. There are bright and dark mental states, or mental states that are on the light side or on the dark side. So this discrimination makes insight into evaluation of all phenomena grow. And thereby, of course, doubt and uncertainty is evaporated gradually. So that one goes through this fourfold evaluation, whether it is advantageous or detrimental, blamable or blameless, exalted or ordinary, and on the dark side or on the bright side. Then this discrimination between right and wrong becomes less and less and less and less. If you have the right on this side, wrong on this side, of the line. Then it's a broad line in the middle where there's a gray zone, where things, it's difficult to discriminate whether this phenomena, being in the middle zone, lying here in the middle zone between right and wrong, the gray zone, whether this is actually right and wrong, whether this is advantageous or not. But by repeated reflection over a period of years, then this doubt and uncertainty goes away by pinpointing out why something is good, why something is advantageous, why something is blameless, and why something is bad, dark, ordinary, low, and detrimental. But one has to do this work. It's not something that devas and or Buddhas can do like this, pling, then impart this knowledge on you. This is not possible. It's work over several years. What feeds the arising and deepening and expansion of doubt and uncertainty? It is frequent and careless attention to doubtful theories and speculative views. This food bewilders the mind and feeds also the escalation of habitual confusion. The frequent and careless attention to things that is doubtful, that cannot be determined. For example, Buddha said there was 10 subjects, whether the world is eternal or not, whether what created the oceans and the world, whether the space is infinite or not, whether a Buddha exists after enlightenment or not, whether he exists, whether he not exists, whether he both exists or not exists, and whether he neither exists nor not exists, and whether the mind is the same as the body, basically whether the mind is the same as the brain. This, he said, was something that could not be determined. It is avyakata, is undeterminable and also unexplained, unspoken of by the Buddha, these 10 subjects that keep up provoking all kinds of theories. For example, this mind-body problem that we have in modern philosophy today, what is the relationship actually between the mind and the brain? This Buddha said in the ultimate course, it is an infinite subject. It's not something that one can come to a conclusion about. When one cannot come to a conclusion about a given subject, then there will remain doubt and uncertainty forever while discussing or thinking about such subjects. This one should be put aside by seeing, ah, this is an infinite going in circle, by disputing with this argument and this argument, that it cannot be determined and it cannot be declared. It's avyakata, it is undeclared by the Buddha. And this is from the Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here. I made 3 videos on the 5 mental hindrances, the Nivaranas. I give them the links below here and below the video and the audio. And there's also 1 audio on the 5 hindrances, and I give it below here and also in the audio. The question 2, why are monks not allowed to handle money, even if it's given as dana to them? I think it's because they are very too tempted to return to lay life gradually. And there's also a question of taxation, and then about what to do if the price is wrong. These issues should be left with lay people. One is allowed by so-called mendaka allowance. Mendaka came and wants to give 500 robes to Ananda, and then Ananda could not use them, but then mendaka was a millionaire, he has to travel away. Then he was allowed by the Buddha to leave some funds with a steward, a lay person outside the monastic Sangha, a capicaro, one who makes allowable these funds, so when something should be built or when somebody else needed a robe, then they could go to Ananda, then Ananda would send a letter to this capicaro, this making allowable steward that had the funds, and then he could go and buy whatever is needed, whether it's robe cloth or roof beams for the monasteries. And this was then carried on. Then what to do today? In Asia, there is capicaros usually at one layperson living at the monasteries, but not so much here in the West, especially for those monks who are living alone, like I do. Then it can be difficult. But basically, the rule says that you're not allowed to handle gold and silver. You are allowed to send a letter to the steward, which should be the steward, the making allowable man, the capicaro, should just be a layman. And this means that this possibly can be a bank, because a bank is employed by a layman. Huh? And this means that you can use credit cards and you can sign checks, but you cannot use cash. Notes, money notes is basically also letters because they're not worth anything. It's just a note from the bank. So this is a disputable object. It is something that is very controversial among monks today, whether it should be allowable and not to use money or use money. In my case in Asia, I didn't use money the first 7 years. But then because the laymen, they had a tendency to taking loans out of the Sangha's money, then eventually after having had four different laypersons that continued with taking loans without telling me about it and the inconvenience caused by that, then I decided to handle this issue myself, because it's very bad karma to take a loan. Basically, you have stolen the money until you tell about that you have taken this loan. But as I said, it is basically because of not reverting back to lay life that monks are not allowed to handle money. But in the West, it can be very difficult if you don't have a steward or a capicaro. There will be maybe one connected with the temples. But outside the temple regime, for forest monks, for example, and even in some temples, there are no laypersons allowed, because it's very expensive to have a layperson employed all the time. And still, when you have a layperson employed all the time, it is still up to the abbot, the head monk, to have the final word regarding the economy, then to sign the bills or the checks or so forth. So it's a very difficult aspect to keep completely free of economy and economical issues of any kind in the Sangha. But it should be kept to an absolute minimum, and it should be utilized, if anything should be utilized, it should be utilized for promoting the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, and nothing else than that. So it should not be handled or by any means utilized, these funds that are allowable as long as they are taken care of by somebody else. They should not be utilized to something else than the Dhamma. I hope this answered these questions. But running a temple, I would guess, is impossible without a monk at least signing checks or signing costs, because that's running cost for anything. And it's not always possible to have lay people to take care of this cost among themselves. So there has to be some person, monastic person, looking at the cost and then recognizing that this money are used for this purpose and this money is used for that purpose, repair of the toilet or whatever. So it's not really possible today to be completely out of economical issues. But it's something that the monks should agree about if these rules should be changed, definitely. Question 363. What is the karmic cause for the Buddha having Devadatta as his cousin brother, who was evil and jealous of Buddha and even tried to kill him and cause split in the Sangha? Yeah, there's several causes, actually. If one goes back to the Jataka story, the primary or the prior lives of the Buddha Gautama, then one will see that he interacted with Devadatta and his former lives many times. And it's said that the first time they become there was disagreement about it was in the Jataka number 3, Sirivaniya Sutta, where the Buddha Gautama, he was one person who went from place to place to buy up used things. And Devadatta, he was a rich merchant. And then there was a place where the whole thing burned down, as also you see in the place called Paradise, paradoxically, in California right now. And then there was a golden bowl. There was an old woman and her young girl who had only one bowl left. It was a metallic bowl, but it was completely dirty, so nobody could see that it was made from gold. And then Devadatta come and saw it, and then he pricked it with a needle, and he could scrape the needle with a needle, could see it was gold underneath this dirty surface. But then he lied and threw it on the ditch and said, was nothing worth. And then he planned to come back and buy it later. But then the Bodhisattva, the one who's going to be Gautama Buddha, came and then saw this and also scraped in it with a needle, and then said, so and so much worth, and then paid this one. the elderly woman and the young girl the right amount. And then he went down across the river in a boat. And there Devadatta then, who later gonna be Devadatta, come down and yelled to the boatman, come back, because he want this golden ball. He was just cheated of his ball. In another birth, so there enmity between these two individualities in a very early point, many thousand lives before their later appearance as Gotama and Devadatta. This happened. Later on, they were brothers that had an heritage of the same rich father, several villages he owned. And then Devadatta, they agreed to go out into the forest to discuss the issue, and then the Bodhisattva actually killed him and buried him down in the ground. So this was the main reason why Devadatta later on came and became very, very jealous at the Buddha and wants to overtake his position from these repeated instances. Early in their life, Devadatta shoot down a swan, and as you see here in the pictures, and then the swan was salvaged or rescued by the Buddha as a young boy. So this was also a cause of enmity between these two. Devadatta tries to kill the Buddha several times by drinking an elephant drunk with toddy, nalagiri, and then making the elephant charge him, but it didn't succeed. The elephant fell down on its knees. By trying to kill himself with hurling a rock out of him from a big place, as you see in the pictures here. And then by sending archers out, first one archer from Ajatasattu, King Bimbisara's son, evil son that has murdered King Bimbisara, which was Buddha's friend. And Ajatasattu then gave him some archers, and Devadatta then said to the first archer, go out and stand there and there, then when the Buddha come from this road, then shoot him down and go back on another road. Then on the other road, he placed two archers. Say, when the first archer come, then shoot him down, and with two archers, and then go back by this road. And there he placed four archers. And for them, so they should shoot each other down, so no rumor or report about the Buddha being killed by any of these archers would reach the town or the city. But the Buddha, he came and beamed universal friendliness towards the first archer, and then followed with him to the second archer. And they all escaped and didn't shoot anybody, and came back to the city where they reported the issue and said that not only had the Buddha saved his own life, he has also saved their life. And he also saved that they have fallen into hell. And this was people who became very angry with Devadatta for good reason. So he tried to kill him several times, but the Buddha was never angry with him because he saw that he also had done something bad towards Devadatta in an early life. And in the last part of Devadatta's life, after he tries to cause schism in the Sangha also, he tried to come back. He realized the Buddha had never been angry with him. He'd been completely neutral. Then he tries to come back to Jetavana to see the Buddha, he was sick, carried on a litter by four of his adherents. And when he entered the monastery, then he stepped down to wash his face and feet in a small lotus pond that was in Jetavana monastery. And when his feet touched the ground, then it opened up and he was sucked down into hell. So he never came into presence of the Buddha, although Ananda was very worried about that this will happen. But the Buddha assured him, this will not happen. This will never happen. So before he came there, he became swallowed down into the hell, Avicii hell, where he still screams. And he will have to stay and burn there until the end of this kalpa, which is probably in the order of 140 billion years from now on. So a significant period. He was taken into the Sangha because the Buddha foresaw that after he's come out of this hell, then he will become a Pachika Buddha, a solitary Buddha in the future. So the Buddha predicted he will become a very good monk, he will attain Iddhi powers, he will convince Ajatasattu by appearing as a bundle of baby snakes in his lap, and then making himself into a monk, and after that he will try to kill me several times. But in the end, after having gone through all this hell, he will become a Pachika Buddha. So he allowed him into the Sangha instead of rejecting him. This is in short the story about Devadatta. So it's a many thousandfold lives where they have been born together, either as brother, two brothers, or brothers or cousins in the same family, having some issues, being together, and then having some issues of either sharing or this or that, or being together in this organization as a Sangha, or being the son of the same father that should, that they should inherit, and so forth. And because of this slowly accumulating enmity, this accumulated in this last very dramatic story about the Buddha and his evil cousin Devadatta. Question 364. Is the Theravada and Tibetan Buddhism the same spirituality? It's the same Buddha. Tibetan Buddhism also have a lot of Bodhisattva, Avalokitesvara, Amitabha, and so on. Basically, the substance of both faiths, both religions, both philosophies are the same. Namely, the last Buddha Gautama and the Four Noble Truths, Noble Eightfold Way, and the three universal characteristics of impermanence, suffering, and no self, emptiness, basically. So this is the same. However, the expression is much different, because the expression in the early text is from 6 months after the Buddha. And the Buddhism first emerged in the 6th or 7th century in Tibet. So there's hardly any text in the text collection is in the Kanyur and the tenure of the Tibetan Buddhism. There's hardly any text of the Buddha himself. While in Theravada Buddhism is almost only text of the Buddha himself. Not exclusively, but almost. So this is basically the difference. Then also, when because of impermanence, that everything decays over time, then over so large time period is more than 1,000 years. The Buddha lived 4 centuries before Christ, and Tibetan Buddhism is 6 centuries after Christ. So this is roughly a millennium that is in between, and there it is mixed with culture. So it is basically Indian Mahayana Buddhism, what early Buddhism has become to in the 6th or 7th century, that has been then traveled to Tibet and then become Tibetan Buddhism, mixed with some Hindu and some Burn culture. Burn was a religion of faith that was in Tibet before Buddhism, and is still also prevalent in Tibet. So Tibetan Buddhism is a mixture of three things. Mahayana Buddhism, a little bit Hindu faith, and a little bit Burn culture. And then in the settings of Tibetan culture. While Theravada Buddhism is what early Buddhism has become to over 2.5 millennia, which also has changed it. Since we are so lucky to have the words of the Buddha, then everybody can recheck with the text and then go back to what is the orthodox thing, because they still have access to what the Buddha actually said in the form of the Tipitaka, the three baskets of texts, which is Vinaya, the disciplinary code, the Sutta Pitaka, and the Abhidhamma Pitaka. But the Sutta Pitaka is the most important, because this is a speech about all the subjects that there is in Buddhist philosophy, to lay people, to kings, to whoever, about what is what the Buddha actually said about these subjects. The first king that introduced King Tsongtsang Kampo was born in 618, and he lived to 649. And then the one who's usually, he's from the 8th century, honored with introducing it, Buddhism into Tibet, is King Trisong Deutzen. He's from 755 to 797. This means the 8th century. So 8th century is 12 centuries after the Buddha's death. And there, considerably decay has happened. And this this one can say is somehow the difference. But the ground, the essence of Buddhism in both expressions are to much extent the same. What about Amitabha Buddhism? Yeah, this is from a little bit earlier. It's 900 years after the Buddha. It's from 402 after Christ, and it's basically a Chinese form of Buddhism called Pure Land Buddhism, grown on Mount Lu, which you see here, which advocate that the practice of reciting the name of the Amitabha Buddha in order to attain rebirth in the Western Pure Land Sukhavati is how you do it. There's three of these sutras, the Infinite Life Sutra, the Contemplation Sutra, and the shorter Amitabha Sutra. You can see it under Pure Land Buddhism on Wikipedia. So they basically recite the names. There's also some Bodhisattvas, Avalokiteshvara, and so on, going on in it. Basically, it says that it's the belief that this world, samsara, will always be corrupt, and we will tend to agree in that. But so you have to make up a, you have to go to a so-called pure land. And actually, I think it's been born out of early Buddhism's notice of that there's 31 levels of existence, and we are on level 5. And there is actually something called Suddhāvāsa, the pure abodes. There's 5 pure abodes, but they are accessible only to non-returners, anagami and arahants. And this means one has to go to either become a noble or being able to access second to fourth jhana to go to these very high levels. Brahma Sahampati, a Brahma Deva that comes down to the earth and requests the Buddha to teach right after his enlightenment, he is said to be dwelling in these pure abodes. They are called, start with level 23, the Devas not falling away, Ahviha Deva, the level 24, untroubled Deva, Attapa Deva, the level 25, the beautiful Deva, Sudassi Deva, the level 26, clear-sighted Deva, Sudassi Deva, and the peerless non-junior Devas, the Akkanita Devas. But it's worth noticing that in early Buddhism, then the lower level, Kamaloka, that is from levels 1 to level 11 that we are inhabiting, there you can go in various levels. There are also divine levels, because we're in level 5, level 6 to 11 is divine. There you can go by giving alone, or like reciting sutras and so on. But the Brahmaloka, which goes from level 12 up to level 27, there you have to do meditation. You have to do meditation. And very, very, I would say, higher order jhana meditation, from second jhana to fourth jhana, one has to access. Otherwise, one is not able to be reborn in these very high subtle levels. And this means that it is probably much more difficult than Pure Land Buddhism thinks, because Pure Land Buddhism advocates that you just by reciting some sutras and the Amitabha Buddha's name, then you can come to these very high levels, being reborn in these very high levels. And this is probably an underestimation and an inaccuracy that has happened over these 12 centuries, from the Buddha died and then until Pure Land Buddhism arises more than 1,000 years later. Again, one can see that there's some significant lack of exactitude between early Buddhism and late Mahayana Buddhism. In this case, it is significant because Pure Land Buddhism will tempt to be think that if they are good beings and they fulfill the 5 precepts and then they recite these sutras, then it is enough to be reborn on a very high level. But if we go to what the Buddha said about it, then this does not seem to be the case. Then one has to do significant training of meditation and reaching a fairly high level of nobility, namely anagami, one who never returns to this planet Earth as a human being, before ending samsara by attaining enlightenment. So there's a discrepancy there. I will say significant details seems to have been lost over these 12 centuries, from the Buddha died and then until Pure Land Buddhism arose on a mountain in the year 402 AC, as 900 years after the Buddha, in China. So somewhere else. So 900 years after the Buddha died, then these later developments of Buddhism arose in China, far from where the Buddha was born. And this was then, of course, very difficult at this distant location, where only translations of what the Buddha had said was very scarce, is even today, not published as common books. You can buy in any bookshop or anywhere. Now you can find it on the internet. But then such significant details about how to reach the pure abodes, the Sukhavati, the pure lands, level 23 to 27 of samsara, how that actually is achieved. Is it enough only to recite sutras? Or is it not only to give? We would say in early Buddhism, no. Then you will stay in the lower third in Kamaloka. You have to do meditation and you have to do significant mental development to become a noble. And a significant, more than 50% enlightenment actually, in order to attain these high levels of rebirth from level 23 to level 27, called the pure abodes. The last question, when we die, do our souls transfer into gold, go into space, and where do we come from? First of all, there's no soul, there's no ego, there's no personality that leaves the body. There's a consciousness that sees here and then it rearrives in another place. But this also it does here in this body. So it sees here and begins again, sees here, begins again, sees here and begins again. So there's nothing lasting soul, identity, ego, me inside there. This is Sakaya Ditti. This is personality belief that there is this. So there's nothing lasting soul or personality or anything reborn. And it's definitely not it's not converted into gold when we die. That's the case. Where we come from is another issue. The Buddha said that we beings arise and wander on, blinded by ignorance and bound by craving, dragged by craving and seduced by self-deception about this I am, this asmimana, this self-deception that I exist, I am. This they do because of ignorance arising. But no first beginning can be seen. So it cannot be seen where beings come from, basically. It cannot be determined. And this first beginning one should give up is a metaphysical question, and it is one of these questions causing doubt, the Buddha said. So this is one should give up, ditch that. However, one can say the cause of the whole thing, samsara starting for any being, is ignorance. Ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. Ignorance of the First Noble Truths of this and such is suffering, dukkha. And this suffering arises because of craving, dukkha samudaya. This arises because of craving, tanha, thirst. And the end of suffering, the third truth, then is simply the absence of all craving. Craving for sensuality, craving for becoming this and that, and craving for not becoming this and that. And the way to make this craving go away is this Noble Eightfold Way, which is the Fourth Noble Truth. Ignorance of that is what makes samsara arise and continue, and thereby makes suffering continue for all sentient beings. There is one little connotation I'd like to say. It's an issue that has puzzled me for a long time, for many years. It is said that when the Arahant die, then his senses, that is his abilities to see, to hear, to taste, to touch, and to think, they are converted into space. And this is really a strange notion, but also very captivating, because in quantum mechanics you have that there is only a cloud of probability unless there is a conscious observer. That is at least one interpretation, called the von Neumann-Weiner interpretation of quantum mechanics. And the ability to observe is of course connected to observe external objects here under quantum objects. Of course is connected to your ability to see, hear, taste, touch and think. So this should have something to do with the amount of space. This seems captivating. There seems to be some kind of subtle connection there. So it could be that the physical world, one could envision a system where conscious beings, they are able to receive input, that is to say they are able to collect information and transform information. This said they are do, they, then it, this makes a space shrink. But when this ability, this consciousness, sense consciousness is released, then it goes into space. So that the summation of all consciousness and the summation of all space then will be a constant thing. So if arahats are lost, then space grows. If arahants come into being or beings are there observing, then space becomes less. This is a very intriguing information. That's what the text says. However, it was also a general belief at the Buddhist time that this was so. So it's difficult to say and to evaluate, but it's something that I have been puzzled about and thought about for a long time without being able to make sense of it. But the text, the early Buddhist text, definitely says two things. You cannot see where the beings come from, and you cannot designate them after they have entered Nirvana. Then you cannot designate where they are or what they are, whether they are or whether they not are, or whether they both exist and not exist, or neither exist nor does not exist. You cannot designate or put any property or designation on them whatsoever. And this goes both for Buddhas and all enlightened beings. Secondly, he says there's no beginning, but you cannot see the beginning in time, nor the place where beings come from, where consciousness arises from in the first place. But one can say the cause of it is arising because of ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. That's for sure. So ignorance is the deepest of the deepest root of suffering that there is. Soon after ignorance come craving. As soon as there's ignorance and craving, then there's ignorance, greed and hate. And then you have the three root defilements that keeps us in existence. May we, by this very speech, be able to discriminate the causes of this perpetuum mobile of samsaric existence, birth, aging, sickness and death, and maybe thereby be able to break out of it. Thank you to all supporters, all regular donors, and all those who have participated over the years with helping the Forest Sangha producing these videos. It is important that you continue, because living here in Denmark is very expensive. So I thank you very much for your support. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamitaya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.